Now, I'm going to interview someone who knows a lot about people power and also who knows a lot about kicking the ass of the state. Her name is Cynthia McKinney. Cynthia McKinney was in the U.S. House of Representatives for Georgia. She was the first African-American woman to be elected to the House of Representatives for the state of Georgia. She is an unbelievable advocate for truth and speaking truth to power. She stood up in when nobody else would and took George Bush to task over the Iraq war. She was the U.S. presidential candidate for the Green Party in 2008. She has been a relentless activist and campaigner. She is a beautiful woman, and I'm very proud to call her friend. And I'm so happy that she is here on the stream with us tonight. Cynthia, you just need to... Oh, I can unmute you. Here we go. Welcome to the vigil.
Okay, great. Thanks so much for including me. I heard a little bit of your previous guest. The fact is, when I was writing my dissertation, I used WikiLeaks because I understood that the documents that had been released by WikiLeaks were like primary sources, US government officials talking to each other. Never expected that the people would be able to actually see the contents of their conversations. There were other documents as well, email messages back and forth. And I wrote my dissertation on Hugo Chavez and the Bolivarian Revolution and people power, and then how people power can become transformed into state power, and state power can actually lead to transformation in the lives of people, something that we all want. And then what happened is the librarian saw my use of WikiLeaks, then she got busy and started researching other dissertations that had used WikiLeaks. Well, as it turns out, there was only one dissertation that had used WikiLeaks. And because I'm a student of COINTELPRO, the counterintelligence program, I understood that these COINTELPRO documents that had been released to the public, but were basically absent in academia, in the use of scholarship, academic research in order to inform us of the quality, character, whatever, of our so-called democracy. And so anyway, the librarian gets involved and says, well, you know, President Obama's just prosecuted Barrett Brown for using the very same links that you use in your dissertation. And so there was this big thing, a commotion about whether or not I, the librarian, because, you know, US rules and laws and all were changed with regard to access to information after September 11th. And so I ended up, long story short, having to completely excise every mention of WikiLeaks from my dissertation. So I was effectively censored of excellent primary source information that was provided by WikiLeaks because the Obama administration had prosecuted Barrett Brown, and Barrett Brown was sitting in prison. So this gives us an indication of the impoverished state of academia, the impoverished state of the media, that and a journalist would be prosecuted for merely linking to information that should be in the public domain anyway. What is secret? Nothing that my tax dollars pay for should be secret from me.
Okay. I completely agree with you.
That's my WikiLeaks story. That's my Barrett Brown story. That's my Julian Assange story. So now what we've got is a situation where when Trump said the system is rigged, yeah, we see that now, that the swamp of governance needs to be drained. Well, yeah, we see that now. But then how are we to do it if we don't have access to the correct information. When the media lie to us about what the government that they're supposed to be covering is actually doing, then we have no idea. And in fact, I believe it was George Herbert Walker Bush who is reported to have said something like, if the public actually knew what we were doing, they would chase us down the street. Yeah, so for us to be engaged citizens, we need to know what our government is doing in our name with our tax dollars. And then we need to stop them from doing things that violate our values. So this is why it is extremely troubling to me that we would have government officials talking about harming Julian Assange. Julian Assange has given us the greatest gift that any journalist could give us, and that is the truth about what our governments are doing. Not just the US government, he's given us all of the information. And what he has effectively done is to put media on trial. And unfortunately, I have to come back, if I am a juror, I have to come back with media is guilty. The of complicity, connivance, misinformation, disinformation, they're guilty of the highest crimes against journalism.
In Don Pilger's words, Julian is only guilty in the eyes of the media because he has been doing the job that they were supposed to do.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right.
Now, so Cynthia, anyway,
I'm so glad that you included me in this online vigil, and I want to do even more. I had a trip planned to London that got changed because the, you know, what can I say, the nattering nabobs of negativism got involved, got active, and so I just decided to come home to Georgia. Well, but I wanted us to do a human chain around the embassy or have a stakeout. And thank you for graciously putting me in touch with the folks there, because I think Julian's life, aside from the fact of not being able to go outside, get your vitamin D, be able to live a normal life and enjoy your right to privacy that everyone has, Julian's life is under attack and threat just from the conditions that have been imposed now and these more onerous conditions. Unfortunately, I have the suspicion, the sneaking suspicion, that the government of Ecuador is involved in a horrible deal that many, how can I say, formerly colonized countries end up dealing with, and that is promises from their former colonial masters of United Nations treats, rewards, whatever. And so the character of the Moreno government has drastically changed from what we expected it to be. And even from the pronouncements of, I think, candidate Moreno. So Julian is under serious, threat. Julian's life is under serious threat. And I think it's a shame if we allow this travesty to take place without doing something. Thank goodness to you, Susie, because you have organized us, you are leading us, and allowing us to give voice to our own frustrations and our outrage. And I thank you so much for it. And you look great, by the way.
Thank you so much. This is how good I look when the kids are out of the house. And I don't have to worry about what the next domestic disaster is going to be for a few hours. So yeah, I'm in a pretty good mood at the moment. I've also just had fantastic person after fantastic person after fantastic person here. And I just feel like, honestly, I'm going to get a bit teary-eyed now because I feel like the luckiest girl on the planet. I am getting to do the work that I love with the people that I love and for an incredibly important cause. I think one of the most important causes of this generation, without a doubt, because if we save Julian's life, Julian has saved and will save the lives of so many other people. So to act on, to advocate for him is to, in my mind, to advocate for all at-risk journalists and whistleblowers who WikiLeaks supports and helps and has protected over the years and would continue to in the future decades, as well as to protect the public's right to know. As you've just so eloquently explained, we own that information that is generated by the governments. That's our property. So when WikiLeaks is returning our property to us, then they are truly performing the public service that our governments have completely failed on. One other point I wanted to make, Cynthia, maybe just to set the stage here for our discussion. I have had talks with you previously about the importance of people overlooking their ideological, getting past their ideological divides and getting out of their own individual little silos and the information silos, but also in their social groups. And we've talked about the importance of finding common ground and commonalities between us so that we can advocate on specific issues and so that we can actually achieve something, because we are not going to win these massive geopolitical fights with 10% of the population behind us, you know, or 20% of the population behind us. We are only going to win these massive ideological and geopolitical fights when we have a mass movement of people united on a single achievable aim. And that is entirely what this is about. This Unity for Jay is all about uniting for the single cause of press freedom, the public right to know, human rights for Julian Assange, protecting and restoring his human rights, respecting his political asylum. These are issues that the vast majority of the world can agree on, regardless of whether they are socialists, conservative, libertarian, environmentalists, Democrats, classical liberals, neoconservative, whatever. We can agree that the press should be free, that publishers should be free to publish, and that we don't want to see publishers tortured in an embassy for 7 years because of their work to enlighten the public, because of them having the integrity to provide the public services that the mainstream media have not been. Guys, Cynthia has just dropped off for a sec. I think her connection's just crashed out. I am actually feeling a little bit guilty because I know that there is untold amounts of comments in the YouTube chat and I'm totally behind on them. And I'm really, 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 really sorry. What I can tell you is that we are going to be continuing these events on the first weekend of every single month. We will have lots of the same faces back again and we will have lots of new faces every month as well. Somewhere, hopefully our awesome mods in the YouTube can take the questions that you have for guests and they get uploaded, I think, to an etherpad that I can look at. So guys, could you do that for me, please? So can we start to compile any audience questions for Cynthia so that when she is back on, she will be able to answer those? Jake Smith's asking, who is on with me now? Presently, Cynthia McKinney, ex-House of Representatives for the state of Georgia, very famously took on George W. Bush over the Iraq War and when he wanted to invade the Iraq War. She stood up and really gave it to him from the seats of power, from the seat of government in the United States, which of course got her targeted and made her an outcast within her own party, the Democratic Party, who should have been in opposition to George Bush's policies. But of course, as we all know, when it comes to militarism and when it comes to war, the Democrats and the Republicans are quite often in perfect alignment with each other. Well, Cynthia was one of the very few warriors for truth who stood up and wouldn't take it anymore. And on behalf of millions of Americans said, no, we do not agree with this. No, we do not want to go to war. And no, we will not go to war on a lie. she also was part of a bipartisan effort to audit the Federal Reserve and the Pentagon. She was one of the first representatives who was really pushing for the Pentagon to be audited, which we've now have heard a lot about in the age of Trump, this happening, a Pentagon audit. But actually the genesis of that is some 15 years ago when Cynthia was advocating for that from within the House of Representatives. So she's an absolutely incredible woman. Now, I've also kind of like a little bit stolen her idea in terms of this having the full political spectrum represented here, because this is a project too that Cynthia has been working on for some time, is that she wanted to find this common ground where no matter our political ideologies, no matter our political affiliations, we could come together and we could achieve actual wins on serious issues that we need critical mass to be able to win on. And so that very much has been an inspiration behind doing this this series of events, because we're wanting to take that same principle and apply it to support for WikiLeaks and support for Julian Assange. If you've heard some of the other interviews I've done recently, I've been talking about, and to a certain extent, my article being Julian Assange discussed the way that both the left and the right are taught to hate WikiLeaks, to be alienated from WikiLeaks or to be alienated from Julian Assange. I call it a pincer movement, and it's a tactic of the intelligence agencies. They will come at one narrative come at the right with one narrative, a smear narrative against WikiLeaks. Like currently it's WikiLeaks has been compromised, don't trust WikiLeaks account, Julian has secretly been ferried out of the embassy and is being protected by Trump, everything's fine and good and don't worry, you don't need to support them, which is total lies. I can tell you from speaking to Julian's mother, his friends, his family and his lawyers, that is the complete opposite of his situation. He is in fact trapped in the embassy. He has serious health conditions. He has no access to medical care, and now he has no communication except through his lawyers, via his lawyers. So what the right are being told is completely wrong. And then on the left, we have the left being told, no, don't support Julian because he meddled in politics in the election and it's his fault Trump is elected and blah, 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 which we also know is false because Julian has published detrimental information about every single administration. He published detrimental information that was detrimental to the Republicans. He published information that was detrimental to the Democrats. He will continue to do so for as long as he is physically able. And WikiLeaks, even no matter what happens to Julian Assange, I believe WikiLeaks will continue to publish information against any corrupt power, no matter what the source of that corrupt power is, no matter what country it is, no matter what political faction it is. You can be absolutely guaranteed that they are going to continue to speak truth to power, and they're going to continue to advocate for the public right to know. So I think that a movement like this, where we take this common ground and this single point of focus and we build support right across the full political spectrum, and where we say, you know what, we don't care what who you voted for, and we don't care, you know, what your personal political opinions are. All we care about is press freedom and freedom for Julian Assange. We can use that to build a massive movement. We can use that to build a movement of the size that is sufficient to put political pressure on the governments and the agencies that have been persecuting Julian Assange and have been persecuting WikiLeaks for years and years and years. And that would be a massive victory. And victory for the people is long overdue. We have been fighting and fighting all throughout this decade. I know I've been fighting in movement after movement after movement. And we are sick of the politics of division. We are sick of being divided into little groups, subgroups that we can be conquered by, in which we can be conquered. And it's time that we took some power back. And I think this is a really good way to start doing that, to start opening up our ranks to decent people from all perspectives and from all realms and all experience and all opinions. I think it's giving a lot of people hope what we're doing. I've certainly heard from everybody that it has been, and I really want to say thank you to everybody. I can see I'm watching the chat. I can't keep up with it all, but I'm watching it scroll and scroll. You guys are amazing. There have been thousands and thousands of tweets put out in support of this event. Ah, Diani, you want to come on early? Okay, I'm going to interrupt the regularly scheduled programming for a minute. Oh, that would be quite cool to have Diani and Cynthia at the same time. So in approximately 20 minutes time, I'm supposed to be interviewing the godmother of all whistleblowers, Diani Baretto. She is an absolutely amazing researcher, journalist, advocate for whistleblowers. She has been working with a number of organizations that support at-risk journalists and whistleblowers for a number of years. Diani, Cynthia's internet died on her, so she'll probably come back in with us, but I couldn't think of anything better, actually, than having all three of us on one panel. So welcome to the stream. You're a little bit early, but I'm very happy that you are. You are now unmuted. Oh, God, I hope your internet is holding up.
I hope I can. So. We've had
some... There you go. You're good.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Nice to be here. Thank you, Susie and Elizabeth, for hosting. I'm honored to be here. Hear me all right?
Your video is a little bit choppy, but the sound is coming through okay.
Okay.
So, Diani, can you...
I can try with my phone. I'm sorry. We've had probably the storm. Internet was just very choppy.
Oh, okay. Diani, could you introduce yourself and your work and give people a little bit of your insight into the importance of whistleblowers and at-risk journalists and the ways, and particularly the ways in which they've been supported by Julian and WikiLeaks for years.
Diani Baretto. I'm a Cuban-American expat living in Berlin, and I fell into this line of work when I decided to support Chelsea Manning about 6 years ago. And then, of course, it was at a time, if you might remember, with Occupy and the Arab Spring and all of that. So that was a very emotional time. And I thought it was a very valid cause. And led to the other. And then you realize, okay, it's not just Chelsea Manning. It's about truth tellers and whistleblowers. And it's the first time I'd actually really heard the term. I didn't know too much about it. I had no idea about the national security state. The opposite, I knew nothing. I just thought he had just been unjustly politically targeted and persecuted. Please stop me if I speak too quickly or if the internet is not working. All right?
It seems to be a bit stronger now. I can hear you better now. You might just want to sit just a little bit closer to the device for volume's sake, okay. but the quality is better now than it was when you first connected.
I'm really sorry, everyone listening here. How's that? Is that any better? Is that any better? Hello?
That is much better, Diani. Sorry, great. I think there's a little bit of a lag, so you just have to give it a second, but there's a...
Try to speak.
Yeah.
So, it was Chelsea Manning, basically, and then I found out about Jeremy Hammond and Barrett Brown, and we started doing public rallies in Berlin in support, and we were part of a very small but very devoted Free Chelsea Manning network in Berlin. It was Free Bernie Manning, if you will remember, and topics, actually. So it was the first, like, a changing back then that we realized, this is the surveillance industrial complex that is upon us. And we were a bit of a strange ragtag way because people weren't listening and we kept trying to tell them. I met some rather devoted activists in Berlin. And then, of course, we had the summer of Snowden. And we had a lot of expat activists moving to Berlin. And we held rallies and we pounded the pavements. And I think we changed the public narrative, especially in Germany, because the word whistleblower does not translate well, to make it a household name and to, encourage parliamentarians to hold this inquiry about the Snowden revelations, for example, which I'll get to that at a later point. And we had a lot of people that were very sympathetic to these causes. It took years, but I'm grateful for a very large community, all different political affiliations and colors, that ended up supporting whistleblowers and bloggers and journalists and people at risk for the public's right to know. The German of Borders Without Borders, for example, that ended up changing their mission statement to protect bloggers and activists. And we did many events here together in Berlin. And so at some point or another, I became like a go-to person for these topics. I just fell into this. I had no proper schooling for this. I'm an artist by profession. I had done translation work. And one thing led to another, and then the inquiry in the German Bundestag, we got to listen to the testimonies of Bill Binney, former executive director of the NSA, and Thomas Drake. Charged with the Espionage Act, the first person to be charged after Daniel Ellsberg, for example. And that's how I got to learn firsthand egregious, very aggressive campaign against these apostates, these heretics of the national security state, because these were insiders. So I found it particularly interesting that people were to incur wrath of the U.S. government. And this was, of course, all it started Bush, if you will, Bush administration. James Risen had reported about that. And then it carried on to the Obama administration. And it was very difficult to try to convey this to a concerned citizenry that Edward Snowden or Chelsea Manning or these other truth tellers are not just an American phenomenon, you know, in terms of American speakers, you know, truth to power. No, this is, if you will, a bit of a should have protections for these people all over the world. This is something that we need in terms of modern accountability of our institutions and our governments. And I think through a lot of this work and the networks that developed, I'm very happy to see that we have truth tellers in Africa and in other countries. And it's been very interesting to other organizations and networks to thrive and develop based on trial and error experience that we've had, how to take care of whistleblowers. So I think that title is way too overblown for me. I always refer to Daniel Ellsberg, the of all whistleblowers. I was referred to that en passant by someone here in Berlin, Jesslyn Radak, who's herself also a whistleblower advocate. And so I think that's just too much. I think learning and hearing the very compelling stories of truth tellers and whistleblowers, I really felt compelled by what happened to them and how their lives had been turned upside down and how they'd become radioactive, or NSA or Thomas Drake would say, you become a universe of one. And that's harrowing, but like nobody talks to you, you're just radioactive. So how do you stay alive? How do you defeat self-harm ideas, ideation, suicide ideation, those kinds of things? So, it just happened. It was just that time where you just had to reach out to these people and say, hey, we can find a place for you. And we can find a solution to these problems. They may seem too large. Like in the US, if you're not going to find employment, maybe we can help you here. We had a very network of people that were willing to offer us apartments or employ them or donate or offer psychosocial or medical care or offer them visas, you know, knocking on doors, or as they say in German, to polish the door handles. But I think at the end of the day, people did want, and that was interesting to you about that. I'm still very keen on these picks and would like to pursue them in the future. I think how to take care of a whistleblower is a really good thing. And I think we're doing this right now with Julian. And to answer your question, I'm sorry, I was big arc there. Julian concerned about many people, let's say, from, you know, alleged sources to other Jason activists or truth from Jeremy Hammond to Barrett Brown and so forth. Of course, Chelsea Manning, very disturbing. We'll get back to that. The latest appellate court, you know, upheld all the charges against her. So we see where this is going with Julian right now. It's very, very disturbing, but we'll get to that. So this kind of solidarity, I think, is very important. You may not be a person, but you need to, it's a life threatening situation. People may not survive this. Have the craft of the national security state will destroy your marriage, will be financially destroyed. You know, the story from CIA whistleblower John Kiriakou is they will do everything to destroy you. So it's important when people actually reach out as, you know, people in prison to show that, no, you're not forgotten, you're loved, you're lauded for your the courageous act, you know, of speaking out or risking everything for the public weal, which is a highly unusual trait in people. That's why I found it so interesting. And these people displayed exceptional courage and character, which I was really, really keen on. And they have a very resilient sense of humor. They happen to be good friends. They're exceptional people. I'm glad to and honored to know some of them and to have maybe assisted in some way or another. But again, the credit's not mine. The credit is with the whistleblowers. And that's why I'm here today, as much as I hate speaking in public. But thank you for inviting me, Susie.
You know, it's interesting that you say that because I hated cameras. I was mortally afraid of cameras. When our live streamer would begin live streaming at Occupy, I would make him inform me when he was going to go live so that I could go in the opposite direction and be nowhere near where the camera was. And I myself, by necessity, started taking protest footage that I could send around the world to amplify our actions. And I never, in over 100 videos that I took and circulated that have been published on news sites and all kinds of places, I never, ever, ever once put myself in the frame because I didn't want to be in the frame. It was like, honestly, it was something people would ask me to speak at events and I'd say, I'm not a public speaker. Why are you asking me? Go ask someone who's a public speaker, right. You know? But at a certain point, I think, especially when you have a series of unique experiences and when you have an obligation to inform people and to tell your story, at a certain point, you really have to. And it becomes almost a responsibility. For me, if I had not finally said, okay, it was me all along, here I am, you know, this is what's really happened, what's really happening. If I hadn't said that, I would have been doing a disservice to my country and not alerting them to really what was happening. I would have been doing a disservice to many of the people I work with as well. And so I feel like sometimes life serves you up not at all what you thought you wanted or not at all what you thought you're expecting, but then beautiful things can come from it. And so it's taken me ages. I know if people watch my documentary, I'm petrified in it. I'm literally petrified. And it's not even because I'm talking about intelligence agencies.
You still there?
Yeah, can you hear me? I was just saying in my documentary on YouTube, Diary of a Person of Interest, where that was the first time I ever put myself on camera, and I'm petrified in it. Like at parts, I'm literally shaking, and it's not because I'm talking about intelligence agencies and surveillance and being targeted, because I had been dealing with that for so many years that I'd already mentally like come to terms with it. But I was just petrified of the camera. And yet people see me now and they're like, wow, you're so like or natural on camera or whatever. It really is something that you learn. And the drive to learn it is the sharing. It is the information sharing. And this, I think is quite synonymous with WikiLeaks and what WikiLeaks does, because I don't think that Julian set out to be in the position that he is in now. I don't think he set out I don't think he set out, you know, with the idea of WikiLeaks thinking, oh yeah, I'm going to meet Lady Gaga and there's going to be a Pentagon manhunt for me and I'm going to end up in the, exiled in the, you know, like, oh, it's clear that this was never the agenda from the outset, but that he
nobody
felt
wanted this outcome. Nobody wanted this
yes,
outcome.
Exactly. Nope. Exactly. We don't choose the outcome. We don't choose the net result, but the choice that we do make is that we have the righteous indignation at the injustice, at the crimes that have been committed and the disservices done to the public. And that gives us the drive to do everything in our power to right it. And then what results from that is actually about the external forces that interfere with us more than it is about ourselves. So for that, I think that as much as you say you're not a public speaker, as much as you wouldn't have put yourself on camera or been on the speakers list a few years ago, you now have an obligation to share the information that's inside your head based on your experiences of these very significant people whose lives have converged with yours. And I'm really grateful that you are here to do that for us. So now I would love to hear about the Summer of Snowden. I'm particularly interested, not just in Snowden, but in people whose lives have been positively impacted by WikiLeaks and by Julian, because I think that by fighting for Julian and fighting for WikiLeaks, that we are fighting for, we're respecting everybody whose lives have been saved by WikiLeaks and Julian, and who in the future would be saved by WikiLeaks and Julian.
Well, first of all, it's much easier to talk to you than me just having a monologue. So thanks for that. Publicly, and I've done this publicly. Oops, my internet is a bit unstable. Correct me if, just send me a, if we break off. I've been just much more effective behind the scenes and organizing, you know, helping with film productions and plays and things like that. And have had rallies, which, you know, we may not be able to garner those numbers that we did in the summer of Snowden, that we could get 10,000 people plus on the street to be very goddamn pissed off about mass surveillance in Germany. But more realist here, because we're on the verge of us, of the eve of the 5th year anniversary of Snowden, as you well know. And as though everything is here and lovely, we should be able to realistically count our losses and what has happened. And this dire situation is also a part of a large scheme of things, in my honest opinion, as you might well know, but maybe for may not. But all topics, see, because the five I'm enrolled this, and you know what Snowden wrote to us, for example, and Germany was a key player in Snowden revelation. So what happened in Berlin, I remember the day that I found out about it. It was like a day like today where, well, Real has been 1 year in prison, like one day in June. But who would do that? How did this happen? You know, we'd been taking care of or advocating for Chelsea, but we had never seen anyone who's willing to go to prison willingly and put their name on it, you know, and incur that great risk. Probably was death, torture, solid confinement, and then left in Hong Kong. Once we started connecting the dots and finding out how this was actually came to pass, and how brilliant one of Julian's mentor, or you know, person who cared for him a great deal, may he, Gavin McFadden, presente, may he rest in power, had this very interesting ideas, approach, and network through his journalistic sources. Yeah, let's reach out. Let's save this very brave whistleblower, and convened and had experience with making blockade. Of course, and who I'm very privileged to know and love as a good friend. People that would actually do and bring this upon themselves and put themselves at risk and maybe never be able to visit their homeland again or see their friends and loved ones again in order to save somebody. So this was all kind of happening in Berlin. Then Berlin became this, if you so, I'm not trying to embellish this, but Berlin became kind of the refuseniks capital, to quote The Guardian. And there were several articles upon this. And then of course, Jacob Apple, Berlin, established network here of supporters. And then of course, Laura, on his behest, also moved to Berlin in order to make this film, or the Citizen 4 film, because she had been stopped so many times at borders that she was afraid that, of course, the material might be confiscated or destroyed. So Berlin became this, unwittingly, became like this whistleblower capital. That many whistleblowers in Germany, it's not part of their culture, and that's part of the changing narrative. So more and more people started moving to Berlin. Okay, you just let me know if it's working. And so it became very interesting that we would have, you know, more films being produced here in Berlin. And of course, we have Julian and WikiLeaks to thank for this. Now, that was, it appears that Snowden took this route. He thought that was the, according to his conscience, the best approach to what he thought his way of putting this information in the public, that he handpicked these two journalists, Glenn and Laura Poitras, for example, because he wanted journalists to sort through the materials and say what belongs in the public interest or in the public domain and what shouldn't, or, you know, he wasn't there to reveal state secrets just for revealing state secrets as a spy would. And he's very old. This is something about whistleblowing. You have principles. Whereas you have less principled whistleblowers, is it for self-interest? Is it for to, you know, seek revenge upon someone or something like that? So although he decided to not go through WikiLeaks, for example, still Julian, in his great wisdom and bombastically important story this is for the rest of the world and would concern everyone from New Zealand, Australia, Germany, the US, Canada, France, other countries and so forth, everything that's contained, you know, in the incredible Snowden trove that he risked his life to share with us because he thought the public has the right to know. Large scheme of things that I think WikiLeaks has also been important, if not vital in establishing this. Unfortunately, they've been labeled in terms of forbidden knowledge. They're a repository of forbidden knowledge, which is a shame because, you know, there's a censorship and ban in the US that you cannot, you know, quote WikiLeaks sources or documents in your PhD, for example, or in academic papers, which I find is an egregious form of censorship. Again, this is also part of this topic here today. So it was very important to help journalists here in Germany to report on these topics. They had previously, for example, been very, very aggressive towards Chelsea Manor, was, you know, categorizing them as being mentally unstable, traitors, a risk and a threat to the state, and so. Important changing of the narrative, and a lot of the people in Berlin were part of that change in the reporting and the narrative. Unfortunately, I wanted to go back to my first comment that why we're on the eve of the fifth year anniversary of the Snowden revelations, we're experiencing unfortunately, a negative in Germany as, they legalized it all retroactively, this mass surveillance. They denied mass surveillance, the Merkel government. And these people fell up the career ladder. And in fact, they got more money to mass surveil and more powers to do so. That was maybe not what Snowden's intentions were, but this is what happens and how hard it is to hold your government accountable to the unconstitutional crimes against the citizenry, if you will. I mean, they derailed themselves from the constitution. And although very angry populace and more people and young people that have been following these topics, we were unfortunately very unsuccessful in halting this retroactive legalization of mass surveillance practices with a nothing burger inquiry that could have been a golden moment in German democracy, if you will. It could have been their church committee moment, but it didn't happen because we didn't have the political will of a coalition government by the Christian Democrats and the Social Democrats, the SPD, which are now at a historic all-time low credibility. And I think this is one of the issues, not to mention austerity policies and so forth. So this was very sad, but it still has to be done and it still has to be honored for what it was. And I hold this 5th of June very dearly in my heart when I read about Snowden's incredibly courageous actions in the newspaper and the very important reporting to eventually the creation of The Intercept. So again, there was a lot of history and a lot of things going on in Berlin, and I'm glad to have been a part of that. But again, we have a major massive going now in these communities and against truth tellers and hacks and anyone. And for example, we have in the US reality when being made an example of to the Trump administration's campaign, don't even think about leaking the war against the intelligence community has been weak. A very leaky ship. And of course, the double standards of who gets to leak and who gets slapped on the hand and who gets to, you know, get slapped with Espionage Act. Publishers, news organizations such as WikiLeaks that do not fear. Am I okay here? Can everybody hear me? I'm just going to check.
We can hear you just fine.
Great.
I turned my video off for a second because for some reason it seems to help your connection, because I assume it means your device doesn't have to load my video as well as yours. You did just
fair
go.
Enough. I hate your monologues.
No, your monologues are fantastic. Look, I'll turn my video back on for a sec. How often is it that we get to talk to somebody who is actually in Berlin through some of the most momentous events in whistleblowing and journalism of this generation? Not often. Okay, we've had amazing people on the stream, but everybody on the stream has come with a different area of expertise, different experiences. This is your area of expertise and you're absolutely owning it. And I'm very proud of you and I'm fascinated by what you're saying. Somebody just described it as riveting. Despite your internet issues, despite, you know, whatever bandwidth issues, it is riveting for people who are huge fans of these whistleblowers to be able to sit here and hear some of the inside story of what it was like for someone who was there on the ground throughout these events. So please, I'm going to turn my video off again. Please continue. Yeah.
Okay. So again, this is on now. Of empire and the Pompeo Doctrine and the empire by WikiLeaks, and they will make an example out of anyone who's willing to publish anything that will embarrass the empire, as we're seeing now. And which I find another interesting aspect of this, how the US government is deploying like COINTELPRO tactics against supporters, volunteers, smearing their reputations either through, let's say the alleged CIA Vault 7-8 source, well, porn. It's like all the men get slapped with some sort of sexual assault allegations, and it's quite boring because very predictable point. We've seen this with Matt DeHart and others, and Jacob Obama and so forth, Julian Assange and others. For example, the PR firm Trevor Gibbon and so forth. You know, these are highly contentious, but this has been able like to divide and conquer and separate communities. And this happened in Berlin, as you well know, as you reported upon this, about this in the Applebaum, the case of Jacob Applebaum. This divided a tour community. And to this day, it's field and pretty much broke. Oh, we're on the winning side, and a supporter for the truth teller whistleblower narrative to keep and encourage whistleblowers to come forward, that they will be supported, that they will find people that will help them, that their defense, you know, people and so forth. I don't think the case, which is very unfortunate, you can see in the case of Reality Winner. I would recommend to everyone to read the latest written in The Intercept by Trevor Tim, president of the Press Foundation, why the left and the right during her case, and in the current state of, you know, Russia has reversed, and how everyone is just political narratives to their own good and just letting language, for example, we should be from all pieces fire. And I think every whistleblower that has come after Thomas Drake has paid very close attention how these cases are handled, how they're argued, how they're argued in the opinion. And the US government tried to keep Chelsea Manning, her, did not give her any voice, her public domain, her physical voice was not allowed to be heard. By Freedom of the Press Foundation, if you recall, they try to silence them like purview. And if we keep them alive, and if we campaign hard and do it every day and make sure that people are talking about this every day, you might get to the point where it got Obama the last 2 days of the administration had to commute and not pardon. I thought that was rather spineless, but that's my personal opinion, to commute her sentence because it was already too deafening. So that was, if you will, a successful campaign, which I'm also proud to have contributed to here in Berlin, that we campaigned very hard and, you know, hustled hard to make sure that there was money raised for defense and for her appeal, which is going to be a watershed appeal. Concerning the Espionage Act, which is the most draconian tool wielded against whistleblowers and truth tellers or journalistic sources, that was conceived over 100 years ago, lodged against spies, not people who are trying to do public by risking everything for the public's right to know. So again, a lot of things, and we're challenged through Berlin, but it's unfortunate, of course, this is my personal opinion. Sadly, we were 5 years on after the summer of Smith, of course, that has something to do with this government that is very beholden, the Merkel doctrine, the US, or the transatlantic doctrine. And pact. Of course, things might be changing now under the Trump administration, that a little bit more sovereignty is desired by their European partners, because they may sense that, of course, that NATO partnership might come back to them, or perhaps within dangerous limits of war in Europe, maybe. We have Germany, we have a buildup of troops in European theater, we have increased expenditure in military budgets, and I'm very much like you, Susie. I've been in the war I very, very alarming, and that's why I heard documents that show citizens what their governments are actually doing is something that is vitally important that we need to keep alive. For example, WikiLeaks in this case, and many news outlets are beholden to the establishment or partisan politics, or you know, or how should I say, mouthpiece, or the agencies. And this is such a strange development. It's highly puzzling and irritating, you know, to see people like Ray McGovern being beat up like that and have his shoulder gratuitously, you know, dislocated and being beaten up like that, because someone from the CIA is actually, you know, going in the Senate hearings and trying to. We've become, I don't know what we've become. It's just very disconcerting, but we need more people to have civil courage and the moral courage to stand up. We need to support independent media, because the what do they call them? The legacy or the heirloom or whatever those outlets are, to say. And it's at the New York Times or the Washington, I mean, I'm not there, but the Russia Hysteriverse has just taken over and common sense has left. Proof has been lodged or brought forth of these very serious complaints, for example, against WikiLeaks or Russia's influence it's like common sense has just it's become a rare point, and interesting and very important to have these kinds of researchers and journalists and so forth, and I don't know, one of the guests earlier was saying, was it Peter Lavelle, I believe, that, you know, get consortium news example can write this because they're retired and they have a book we won't get, and that they have the time and the wherewithal and the passion to do this kind of, healed and in good positions don't display the same sort of moral courage. So again, that's why I'm here today. We need to support Julian Assange and WikiLeaks at this very, very critical impasse. We don't know what's going on under this new administration of Lenin Moreno. There's military agreements being made in the back channels. Ecuador is a small country, of course, can buckle to that kind of pressure. And we need to be able to speak up. Of course, the US can be a lawless state because they are the empire. But a small country such as Ecuador to not uphold asylum, political asylum, or afford Julian free speech, which is guaranteed by their most amazing constitution. And as everyone has pointed out, free speech is our free speech, and we need to fight. That's what you do. You know, free speech is something that you just don't earn. You have to continuously fight for it. Come back, Susie, and tell me, ask me a question.
You're spot on. You're spot on, Diani. I've got one. Cynthia's back with us, and I'm going to bring her on.
Hi, Cynthia. Nice to meet you.
But I've just got one more thing. I've got to ask you, and I hope I'm not publicly outing you here. I'll just ask you it in a really innocuous way, and you can decide if you want to respond to it.
Okay.
I believe that you were recently at a location of significance with a person of significance. I was wondering if you'd like to share that experience with us in the context of that person maybe being in an uncomfortable situation.
Well, thanks for the question. I did publicly, because I wanted to publicly not buckle and show my for Julian. In spite of the Luke Harkins and the Guardians conspiracy, you know, about the visitors and so forth, I'm not a mule for hard drives, and no, I'm not the courier. So anyway, it takes a little bit of courage to say yes, I did bring him some food and some really nice smelling spring flowers and just say hello.
Oh, that's so nice.
As a supporter, and we had some very excellent Mexican food. I'm a Latin American, I love cooking. And I hope he enjoyed that, because I think, you know, if in this ridiculously small enclosed space, there's not much cooking going on. And I think that maybe home cooked really good, you know, raise his spirits. It was all very friendly, just pretty much asking basically and just try to, you know, have a couple of laughs, talk about, you know, other things, the impending doom or something like that. The case of Reality Winner, for example. And, you know, I have supported all the whistleblowers, you know, and I, you know, where's my support kind of to that? I know that, you know, John Kiriakou and Matt Ho and others have been tireless in their vocation to speak out, but every possible occasion, Lisa Ling and Sean and others, and I've tried to help and facilitate those kinds of intense debates or counters. We see how much influence, basically, and yeah, we just need to maintain these kinds of channels open. I'm really disturbed that he's incommunicado. I'm concerned that people who are close to him and are friends and bring him good food, because food is very important, especially in your need proper nutrition. And if you can't go shopping for yourself, who is going to cook for you, bring you food, or, you know, offer comfort or companionship? I know he has a lot of friends that used to come just cheer him up and so forth. And now that's not happening. This is a very serious case. And understand, well, journalists speaking up, if the same fate, if they would suffer the same fate, God, you'd wish that, you know, other journalists would speak and say, oh my God, you know, I can't get medical attention, I can't leave, you know, the building, I can't, you know, undergo an necessary pain, I'm separated from my friends and loved ones, I cannot receive information. Of course, these are all universal rights, human rights, you know, the access information or to impart information. Free speech has fearless speech, which we all admire. So yeah, that's why I was there. We were in London for a 15th anniversary of whistleblower Catherine Gunn that had gone to the Guardian's Observer and pretty much blew the whistle on the UK's and
intelligence, yeah, for their work. Well,
right, so I happened to be in London, so that's why I happened to go there, because if you're in London, and back then you could do that, to go and meet granted that the embassy and so forth, you had to go through security and so forth, if they're, you know, and if there was time and space for that, say hello. Sorry, but you go in person.
That's amazing. Okay, Diani, I know how much is in that head of yours that is going to be of interest to absolutely everybody. So I would really appreciate it if we can bring you back on next month, first weekend of next month. But I would really like it if you could do it from CCC with Andy, maybe, but definitely from CCC. Use their Wi-Fi. Have a little crew of CCC. Have a little crew of CCC techs around you. That's the best.
It's just like their Wi-Fi networks and their DSL is like a third world country. I'm really sorry to say that, but
that's okay.
But thank you very much for having me on. And hello to everyone.
I think having you at CCC would give you probably the best tech support, arguably, of anywhere in the world.
Good. It's just Sunday and I'm home with my daughter, so I had to do it from home.
I so appreciate you coming. It's absolutely fantastic.
Thank you for your work, and thank you for this vigil. I know how much work goes into it. Thank you to everyone who's, you know, joined in at the last moment, and I hope that we're more and more, and we get louder and louder, and that we manage to get Julian reconnected, and that we should speak very loudly for his safe passage.
Oh, I hope so too, and we are certainly going to keep fighting for that. Thank you so much, Diani, for being here. It was really special.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.
Night,
bye from Berlin.
Bye, Berlin.
We miss you. Take care.
See you. Okay, back by popular demand. Literally, I've had people tweeting at me, when is Cynthia coming back on, and what happened to Cynthia? Cynthia was killing it, someone said. Cynthia was killing it. And someone else like, preach to us, preach. So, Cynthia, take us back to church.
Oh, I haven't been ordained yet.
the church of freedom of information, of yes. Unity of unity of purpose, and of speaking truth to power. That's the cathedral we're in tonight.
Yes, that's right. And I guess we cannot receive enough of it, you know, because the sad fact is, like, as you know, I started this journey in Asia when you and I first began to talk. And now I'm in the United States. I'm at home with my mother and I'm watching, right? I've been here about 48 hours. Still a little bit jet lagged too. And so I'm just at a complete loss at how the US media have so deteriorated. Now, maybe they were always bad and I just didn't know how bad they were because I was young, I was indoctrinated. But a careful reading of the COINTELPRO papers informs me that they were that they were bad back then, and that there were hundreds of US journalists who were on the CIA payroll. They were beaming that information illegally into the minds of people of the US, propagandizing people of the US, even lying, outright lying to people in the US. There were media houses, there were publishing outlets that were also owned and or controlled by the US intelligence services, whether it's the CIA or the FBI. And so when I look at what's happening in the US right now, all with the Trump stuff going on, and I'm saying, well, there was no rule of law. We haven't had constitutional rule of law since we had the Constitution, really? And we haven't had this sort of respect for the Constitution and the law. We just haven't had it. So now what is our responsibility to change these things. And that is, one, we've got to understand just exactly what the reality is. We've got to be able to make an assessment of the lay of the land, to understand what's real, what's not real, what's right, what's wrong, to understand who we are, our position inside the system, and what we're going to do to change our positions in the system. Until we actually do that or begin that process, everything is going to end up being sort of like a half measure. For example, it's Fred Hampton, who it's Fred Hampton, no, Fred Hampton, not Fred Hampton Jr., who says that I'm tired of, how did he put it? Accepting explanations that don't explain, answers, conclusions that don't conclude, and answers that don't answer. And so that basically is where we are. We're not getting the responsible conclusions that we're supposed to gain, whether it's on policy or anything else, because everything is so skewed. Everything is so kind of warped right now. And so I guess you could say that we all are dripping with the swamp, the residue from the swamp. And so now was one thing for us to understand it, to recognize it, to know it. Then there's another aspect of this, is that once we know it, once we recognize it, how can we change our circumstances? And that's where you and I are. Because you are on the front lines defending someone who actually did what we say is the ideal behavior for us to participate in. When we see something wrong, we try and do our best to correct it. And that's what we're doing now. That's what Julian did. That's our responsibility as responsible citizens. That's our responsibility as engaged citizens, to see something wrong and try to right it. Now, we had one person in my political experience like that, and that was Bobby Kennedy, who but he was killed. Well, of course, we have the experience of John Kennedy, but the situation with Robert Kennedy and Martin Luther King, that whole decade of assassinations that took place that literally warped our political aspirations and changed them from dreams that could become reality to the nightmares that we've been, that perhaps we're still living in. And of course, that, what does that mean, really? It means that we have to put ourselves in alignment with whatever it takes in order to stop the one nightmare that we've gathered around each other for. And that is the nightmare that's being visited upon Julian right now. And it's so important for us to think of ways that we can always elevate the cause of Julian Assange. Julian's cause really is our cause. It's my cause. It's your cause. It's my next door neighbor. How can my next door neighbor be satisfied when we know that Julian Assange is being held incommunicado? We don't know what the conditions are that he's confronted with. We've got horrible tripes being put forward in the public about, well, they're really just sick and tired of having to bear with the presence of Julian in the kitchen at the embassy. I mean, you know, all kinds of ridiculous things that are memes that are being put out there that are quite frankly insulting as well. And so we are not daunted by the task that is before us, but we are innervated because of that task and the correctness or the rectitude of our mission.
Cynthia, when you got cut off before, I think actually your battery went flat. It wasn't your internet that cut out. But when you got cut off, I was just giving my epic speech about how this movement, I kind of stole the idea from you because because you, I know, already had a significant endeavor underway planning to do exactly this, which is to unite people from all different political factions, all different political affiliations and opinions, break down that divide and conquer playbook, bring everybody together, give them one single focus. Here's something we can achieve if we do it together. Here's something we all agree on, and never mind everything else that divides us. Let's put it aside, leave the egos at the door, leave the politics at the door, focus on this, and let's have a win for once. Let's really have a win. So that's what Unity for Jay means to us. And we've managed to pull people into the stream that would never appear together normally, that are from complete polar opposite ideologies, opinions, groups, affiliations, that voted for different people, that didn't vote at all, that whatever. And I feel like this is a beautiful and hopeful sign that, yes, people can coexist, can discuss, can have open dialogue, can find commonalities. I would like to know how it feels for you to see, like, you know, 30 people of such a, like, disparate disposition come together in light of you already having put that little manifesto together saying, this is what we need to do. This is what we need to do.
Well, this, what it shows us, and your effort, the success of your effort shows us, is that, yeah, you know what? We can come together. We can come together over this particular issue. Now, what is this issue? We might say some people who have joined your vigil might say the issue is Julian. And other people would say maybe the issue is freedom of speech. And some other people would say the issue is access to journalism. So everyone who comes into Unity for Jay has their own particular reason for coming into Unity for Jay. But at the end of all of those disparate reasons coming swirling around in that wonderful soup, the bottom line is that, yeah, we find out through this wonderful experience that we can talk to each other. We can have a conversation, sorry for that ring, that we can join in with each other, and that we don't have to end up being the same thing. We don't have to end up being the same person. We don't have to end up being exactly alike. We can come together for Julian, for all, with bringing all of our different rationales, and we can emerge stronger for our ultimate objective, which is Julian. Isn't that
That is beautifully put. And I would add, because it just sparked the thought in my mind when you said that, that the state, it is the state that tries to enforce conformity. It is the state that wants us all to learn the same thing, grow up the same way, have the same experiences, want the same things, desire the same things, spending our time doing the same things, et cetera, et cetera. This is how the state functions to control us. We don't have to do that to each other. We don't have to force each other to conform. We don't have to be carbon copy Agent Smiths from the Matrix.
Thank you so much. This darn message is going on forever. people have just begun to understand that I'm back in the U.S. and this phone hasn't stopped ringing. Sorry about that. But yes, you're absolutely right that this is an opportunity for us to demonstrate how easy it is for people from these diverse backgrounds to come together. Now, of course, I also understand that at the end of it all, what we're going to have to do is push more issues into the smaller space. And therefore,
Don't worry, we can't hear it, Cynthia, so go for it.
Oh, okay, great. That's very helpful, because now my mother's bringing the phone to me so that folk can contact me. So anyway, so yes, and so this is what I think in the end, this is the culmination of any particular idea that I would have, but that I know we all share, of being able to come together and defeat that divide and rule tactic. It is a tactic that has been quite successful, because the major media have successfully divided us, along with the powers that be that control those media, have successfully divided us along, well, we've got a population that's balkanized in any kind of way that you can balkanize a population, we're there. And some may call it identity politics, they can call it whatever they want to call it, but the bottom line is that it facilitates that divide and rule kind of activity that keeps us sort of siloed off, separated, and then ruled. Well, how can we defeat divide and rule? That's got to be one of our main objectives. And why the unity for Julian is so important, because as you have correctly put it, people are coming from all different backgrounds, points of view, left, right, which of course I believe there's a whole new kind of political paradigm now. And this left-right thing is something that is used to carry out the divide and rule strategy or tactic. But that now what we are evidencing through Unity for Julian is that it is possible for us to defeat divide and rule with a practical application. Now, we kind of had an idea about this when, if you go back to Paulo Freire, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, one of my favorite books to learn from. And at the very end of Pedagogy of the Oppressed, Freire gives us the paradigm, really, for resolving this issue. And that's what I want to test in my power cells idea. Okay, so basically what Freire gives us is he gives us the four mechanisms of oppression, and then he also gives us the four tools for liberation. And so basically those mechanisms of oppression, one of which is divide and rule, what we just were talking about. The other one, conquest. Another one, manipulation. And then the final one was cultural invasion. But just as Freire gives us the mechanisms that power uses to control and dominate us, he also gave us the tools that we can use in order to liberate ourselves. And he called those the tools for liberation. What are those tools for liberation? Well, unity for liberation is one of those tools. Cultural synthesis is another one of those tools. Cooperation, another one of those tools. And cooperation, organization is the fourth one. So we've got cooperation, organization. Now I can't even think.
but I just mentioned them. And so those are the, sorry about that. So we have embodied in Unity for Julian, Unity for Jay, Unity for Julian, what do we have embodied in Frady's Tools for Liberation? We've got cooperation. And so that means that we're learning to work with people we've never worked with before. Isn't that wonderful? So we've got cooperation. We've got unity for liberation, because we, despite our varied interests, backgrounds, perceptions that we bring into Unity for Julian, bottom line is we have one mission, and that is we want to protect Julian Assange. Cooperation, unity, organization. Organization is demonstrated by the fact that we've even got Susie Dawson organizing these vigils, these internet vigils. So this takes a kind of organizational skill that is needed if we are to free ourselves from the oppression that sort of presides over us all in one way or another. And then the final one is cultural synthesis. And so basically what that is that all of us coming from all of these different backgrounds and whatever, but the bottom line is when we are together, we are together. When we come together with this singularity of mission and singularity of goal, we also are creating something new in terms of the kind of culture that results from all of us coming together. We're creating something new. So this is the embodiment, in my opinion, of Unity for Julian, is the embodiment of the Tools for Liberation, use of the Tools for Liberation, as described to us or as theorized to us by Paulo Freire. So now I would like to do a similar thing with the power cells in the US, so that our result is that by coming together, utilizing these four tools for liberation, that we can liberate ourselves from the political, social, cultural oppression that serves itself by dividing us. I think we can do it because you're demonstrating here that we can do it. We can do it for one issue. And imagine if we have a power cell in every state of the United States. And that power cell is comprised of individuals who voluntarily come together and say, we recognize that we are oppressed in various ways. Oppression manifests itself in our lives. And we want to rid ourselves of the deep state's ability to divide us so that we are never able to reach our ultimate objective, which is the expression of our individual sovereignty and our freedom. Well, imagine that if we can build this kind of freedom infrastructure in every one of our 50 states in the United States, then maybe the United States can begin the process of transformation, which it talks about regime change. Okay, well, we can have some regime change in the US, and it's all brought about by people power saying we've had enough, we're organized, we're united, We are going to create a new culture for liberation. Oh, wow. Imagine that. Oh, I can't even imagine the force for good that the United States could become.
It's the dream. It's the dream that you were just talking about. You're talking about the decade of the 60s, you know, Martin Luther King, Robert and John Kennedy. You were saying this is, we had the dream, that was the decade of the dream that we could realize. And we are now sitting here, what, 50 years later, and we still have the dream.
Yes.
We still have the dream, but maybe we have a few more tools to realize it.
Yes. Well, you know, and what?
Central to that is each other.
Absolutely.
Each other is central.
But now, you know what? In the 60s, we almost won. Susie, this is the thing. We almost won, because I came just on, you know, I was like on the cusp of all of that, not the leading edge, but the back edge of that near victory. And so I was personally dashed. I was personally stabbed. My dreams were personally doused by that decade of assassinations.
And but not entirely, because look at everything you have done since then. And obviously that had a heavy influence and impact on you. You put yourself on the line. I mean, you have the role that you played tackling the almost solo, tackling the military industrial complex at a historical moment where everybody had been fleeced into going along with the status quo. And the status quo was, yeah, let's bomb millions of people. Yeah, yes. Let's turn Iraq into a parking lot.
Yes.
You had, right. You had the courage. You had the courage. You had the fortitude. You had the words. You had the words. You had the message. You had the message. You were able to stand up and absolutely nail it in a way that 15 years later, people are still sharing the video.
Yes, yes. Well, you know, I had a lot of friends who propped me up. I had a lot of friends. Oh, you're going to make me cry now. Because when I start to remember people like Mike Rupert, who was standing, he was standing in the doorway of the House Armed Services Committee meeting when I challenged Rumsfeld on 9/11. And then there was O'Meara. I can't remember her last name, her first name. How come I can't do it? I can't remember. She's a journalist. And they were helping me. Oh my gosh. You know, the sacrifices that people have made, the contributions that people have made, what we don't have now, that this is when I think about those times and I think about what's possible now, because I do in kind of way think that we are almost recreating 1968, you know, that thing, recreate 68. Because we in the 1960s, we had critical mass. And the only reason the state had to resort to assassinations on every level, I will remind you, not just those political icons, but our opinion leaders as well. That's the story of COINTELPRO that has not yet been fully told. But the reason the state had to resort to assassinations was because we were winning. And so September 11th, 2001 was sort of like the culmination of their victory over us. And that's when you combine the effect of, well, you know, in network theory, it's sort of like, how can you destroy an organization? And decapitation is one of those ways. It's not the very crude ISIS videos that were created by the $500 million contract that the UK gave for media perception management. But the decapitation of organizations by eliminating, neutralizing, to use the language of the FBI and COINTELPRO, by neutralizing its leadership. And so you neutralize the leadership, you decapitate the organization withers, and your threat then is diminished. And this was the model that was used by the owners, the controllers of the US deep state. Now they've changed. That was back in the 1960s. It's a whole new crowd that controls the US deep state now. And that is, that's the process. But our ability to defeat that new crowd that controls the US deep state remains the same. And you correctly pointed out that it's about people power. There's only a few of them. And even with all of the power, the technology, we are in a race, however, because the intrusiveness of the technology now comes, their technology through nanotech can go down into our cells, right? With what we breathe, with what we consume, we don't know what's in our food. I just posted on my Twitter a thing, you know, a video saying we don't even know what's in our food. So their ability to change us in ways that we are not even aware of demands that we understand that we're in a race for our freedom and that the situation is urgent. Now, I've been screaming for 26 years. 26 years, the same thing. But now, for whatever reason, there's a lot more people who are screaming too. And so I really don't care who you were yesterday. And this is what we have to, this is where we all gotta, you know, kind of help each other get to. What's really important is, where are you today? And if you're beside me, and maybe I'm in a silo and you don't know that we are together, then let's kind of pull that down and relearn the most human of all of our characteristics, and that's communication, you know? And that's how, when my relationship with you is mediated by this thing, and we're just doing this thing, and it's not this thing, that we're hugging each other and touching each other and feeling each other and crying together, laughing together, because honestly, you know, it can, technology can help us, but we cannot lose sight of what makes us human. And we cannot divorce ourselves from those feelings. And I'm so thankful to you for helping me to remember, oh my gosh, all of those whose sacrifices we stand on right now. And what we had back then was, we had people also on the inside. We need people on the inside too. You know, Amilcar Cabral said that there's always going to be some kind of how can he called it, I think he called it class treason. Well, I wouldn't necessarily look at it that way. There will always be people from every walk of life who support us, right? And so the reason Kelly O'Meara and Mike Rupert were standing outside that House Armed Services door when I asked Rumsfeld those questions was because we could play the inside-outside game and be stronger together. Now, we need that. We need that, but we need to know who is ours. Because the, what did Huxley say? That with the propaganda, by the end of it all, they will have us loving our slavery or loving our enslavement. And so our heroes cannot be created by them. Their propaganda cannot create heroes for us. We have to create our own heroes. That's what we've got to do. And that's why it's so important for us to continue these vigils for Julian. And like I said, I want to do a physical presence there too, because he's already shown us the photograph of the snatch team that's outside the embassy. And that could happen at any moment. So we need to station people 24/7, 365, so that we can have some eyes on that. I'm sure that's being done. I just want to be part of it too. I want to join in and make my contribution as best I can, in a way that those who are leading in that effort think is appropriate for me to make.
They actually, what you just said before about they had to resort to assassination because we were winning in the 60s, they have had to resort to basically trying to kill Julian Assange because WikiLeaks was winning.
That's right.
You can't win any more than publishing the CIA's most sensitive information on how they penetrate their targets. And that's precisely what WikiLeaks did with Vault 7. You can't win any more than having a US Army insider leaking evidence of war crimes committed in Iraq, as Chelsea Manning did. Winning in terms of achieving the objective of returning information that has been generated by public money to the public and showing them what it is that they've paid for. And I just had shivers that entire time you were just speaking, because I could see so clearly that, yes, I mean, this is something I actually learned long ago in terms of my experience in activism. I learned that at a certain point, you could tell who the saboteurs were within the movements because it didn't matter what their names were, didn't matter what their faces were, didn't matter what their individual cover story was. You could always tell who they were because they have the same training and they use the same methods.
Mm-hmm.
So I learned, at first I was very confronted by I was shocked by how could they be undermining our legitimate moral ethical efforts, how dare they? But after some time, I realized that there's no point focusing on them at all, because even if you get rid of them, another one comes straight in. But you can always tell them because they use the same methodology to undermine the movements. That is a weakness. That's a weakness that can be exploited. Because what we're seeing play out here is that although there's different people in the deep state, different players in the deep state, because it's been 50 years, they're still running the same methods. They're still using the same old playbook. They got the same training. These are the only ways that they know how to deal with us winning, the public winning, is these, their counterinsurgency doctrine, their methods of oppression. They just recycle them because it's worked in the past, and they think it'll work in the future.
That's right.
I think Occupy was, I'm always talking about Occupy because I see it as being something different and something significant. When Occupy spiraled to 2,000 cities in 2 weeks, there was a period of time right at the beginning as that was happening where there was total silence from the government, silence, like there was no press conferences, no government response to the movements, nothing in the media. The media weren't saying it. They weren't even saying dirty hippies or anything yet. It was too early for that. There was a period of about 10 days to 14 days where it was total silence from the entire governmental infrastructure as people were just massing in the cities. And I remember us saying to each other, what are they going to do? How are they going to respond? And the thing is that they were dealing with something they hadn't dealt with before. They didn't have a model for it because of the speed at which the movement spiraled. And the speed was because of the technology that we were utilizing. Mm-hmm. And on even day one of our occupation, we were on web conferencing software like this with 20 or 30 cities around the world talking to total strangers who were doing the same thing in their city as we were doing in our city. The deep state had not encountered that before. The two-week time period before the media started smearing and the police started harassing and the infiltrators showed up to work to try and sabotage the movement, that beautiful two-week period, it actually felt like the new world was here, the new world was coming, we were building it. But in that two-week period, what was happening is the messages were having to go from the ground up the ranks to the next rank, to the next rank, to the next rank, through all of the middle management, up to the senior managers, up to the executives, up to the people in the frickin' White House, mm-hmm. to tell the minions how to respond. And then right. the messages had to pass back down through the senior management, through the middle management, down to the guys on the ground. It took them 2 weeks to get their shit together as to how they were going to destabilize the movement. And that taught me something that is very reminiscent of what Julian has said. Julian said that WikiLeaks was able to achieve things because it was small and agile and it was fast. It was fast. WikiLeaks didn't have to wait for 6 levels of middle management to send their emails. WikiLeaks didn't have to wait for instructions to come down from on high. You know, so that taught me that winning is still possible. And that using new techniques, new technologies, things that they don't have methods or training to address, can deliver victories that in the past we were unable to secure.
Yes, I think it's pretty clear that I look at the Occupy movement. Actually, I need to do some writing about the new forms of leadership that are a result of our lessons learned from Occupy, and also maybe how we can replicate that. Now, you know, Barrett Brown has something like that called the Pursuance Project. And I think what he is looking at is this same kind of decentralized model of information knowledge sharing. In the academic literature, I think it would be called complexity leadership. And so you could look at what's being created as a complex adaptive system. And you could look at the society, the new society that's being created as a complex adaptive system that has emergent learning and emergent leadership. So it's the exact opposite of this top-down kind of thing that you're talking about, where they had to go up, and that's the typical bureaucratic structure. And so there's not one leader, there's not several designated leaders. You can become a leader on the fly. You know, you're a leader on the fly.
Now we're talking.
Yeah. And so once we unleash the power of that individual leadership on the fly, oh my gosh, with our objectives and not theirs, I think it would be wonderful. And there are some young people who actually are working toward that end. And this is what's so gratifying to me, and why I'm so happy to be with people who are not my age, people your age, because you guys are actually testing all of this, trying to figure it out. You're taking your experiences, which unfortunately have been mostly bad experiences with challenging the powers that be, and learning from them, and actually building something. Because right now, you know, in my opinion, the average person, my mother's next door neighbor doesn't have a stake in the current system. Even my next door neighbor, I haven't been to my home yet. I haven't visited my home yet. My house, I should say. But my next door neighbors, my neighbors don't have any stake in this system. You know, everyone is made to believe that they have a current stake in the system, but the system is a swamp. The system is rigged. And we have been totally neutralized from having any voice in the system. Even our voting mechanisms, while imperfect in the past, for sure, are most imperfect now, as mediated by technology with the electronic voting machines. So we can't even count on, in fact, you know, I did a lawsuit. I didn't do it, but the citizens who were basically defrauded of their vote being counted in my bid for re-election, the lawsuit was filed. The state expert witness, the state spokesperson, made a comment under oath in the courtroom and said that, well, the public just has to trust that the person who is announced by us as the winner is the actual winner of the election. They said it in the courtroom.
That's exactly how I feel about the New Zealand electoral system, actually, but I'll leave it there.
So now this is what? Voting by faith? I can pray by faith, but I don't want
to. Counting by faith. God, every step of the process requires faith. And then you only get to have that faith once every 4 years, because God forbid that you did it every week.
That's right. So I have, the more I have been victimized by the system, of course, I couldn't even carry the lawsuit out to its logical conclusion because we ran out of money. So now what kind of justice is that that depends on money?
It is justice for sale.
That is exactly
right. Justice for sale.
That's right.
Okay, I want to bring this back. It's so tempting because, God, to be honest with you, I could do a 25-hour stream just with you, Cynthia, quite easily. But you're so easy to talk to. You're so fascinating to me personally. Your experience is so vast. I mean, the things you were talking about in the 60s, Rob, I'm like riveted because I wasn't there. I was negative 12. in 1968. You know, so for me, it's, and you know, I watch documentaries and whatever, but to hear like lived experience from you it resounds more for me to hear a personal testimony from you than it does just to like watch whatever, you know, production company has done a documentary about it. Right. I could just talk to you on and on and on, but I'm also cognizant that we need to get back to that singular focus of why we are here. I do also see all of the parallels between the things that we're discussing and the accomplishments of WikiLeaks and of Julian, the technological advancements of WikiLeaks, part of why we have an edge, part of why we are able to innovate and force the state to have to adapt to our changing tactics, our changing methods. That is really, really key. Thing, you know, the types of technology, the electronic drop boxes, secure drop boxes that WikiLeaks has pioneered, but also their own agility. I think something that is massively underrated in the public sphere about WikiLeaks is, and Julian actually, is their propensity for solidarity. I have seen them act time and time again out of nothing but solidarity, sheer solidarity. Situations where they don't have anything to gain, but they make that moral stand. They support people for those moral and ethical reasons. I was wondering if you have any experience of WikiLeaks in that regard, and them acting to, you know, we talked earlier in the stream, we were discussing when WikiLeaks had shared Cassandra's work, shared my work, shared Elizabeth's work. They shared my work from the ground in New Zealand at a time when the entire New Zealand media was blacking me out. Mm. And of course the police state was trying to shut me down. They don't just publish censored documents, they amplify censored voices. There we go. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
They amplify censored voices. They have a talent for recognizing those of us whose voices are being suppressed or who are being censored. And blowing the lid on that censorship by circulating the censored information to millions of people, millions. The entire New Zealand mainstream media combined didn't have the reach that WikiLeaks had from sending one tweet of my work. So wow. The national media, if you add up all their Twitter followers, probably wouldn't have come to half what WikiLeaks have in New Zealand, the New Zealand national media. So each time they would do that, they were completely blowing the lid on the containment strategy that was being run against my work. So I was wondering, in what ways have you seen WikiLeaks acting in solidarity with journalists, with whistleblowers, and how important is that? That solidarity is like the lifeblood that keeps us going, right?
Well, you know, my experience with WikiLeaks, I would like to just say from like the very beginning, there was always this question about the integrity of WikiLeaks. So I think I need to say something about that because that's one of the findings that got excised from my dissertation. So there was a lot of suspicion in the very beginning. Okay, to whom does WikiLeaks belong? Is WikiLeaks a platform for the deep state? Is which deep state of all of the states is WikiLeaks a platform for? All of that was out there. And there was suspicion about the integrity of the platform, the integrity of Julian. Who is Julian? The integrity of the information that's placed on the platform. So as part of my kind of research, I contacted some of the people who were associated with WikiLeaks that I knew. And what I got back was total vindication. It was like, no, we don't represent anybody. We represent the truth. We represent the facts. We represent the documents. Unfettered access to what was written by the time you're talking about the plus D database, I think there were the Kissinger files. There's, you know, all these different, oh my gosh. So then I was able to really sleep well in my support of WikiLeaks and Julian, because I had been told by people that I trust who were inside the sort of the boiler room. Yeah. All we want to do is get the information out. That's what WikiLeaks is, getting the information out. Okay, I'm down with that. So I think that whole issue now, I don't think it comes up very often about the integrity of the platform itself, not talking about the, you know, sort of technological interaction and how you do that. But what they also have done is they have provided kind of an information on how we should engage our information with this technology. Now that is huge in terms of, okay, my laptop or my cell phone, if you're using the little cell phone thing, or my iPad or my tablet or phablet, is not a neutral piece of equipment. And now we know that.
That's true. It is. We're inviting the state into our home and saying, please spy on us. In many cases, you know, many cases, Alexa and all of this nonsense. I mean, you're literally inviting the government to live with you.
That's right. That's right. And so we just, in terms of even that, and, you know, being able to understand that this little piece of technology and the software that powers it or fuels it might have already been invaded, and it might not be mine. Just like the leaders that they want us to believe are our leaders might not be ours, you know? So what WikiLeaks also invites us to do, or maybe not only invites us, but requires us to do, is to add another layer of, I don't want to say security, to add another layer of defense in order to protect our own integrity. I think that's what I want to say. And that strictly has come about because of the information that's been given to us by WikiLeaks. You're right. I was a part of those. I'm on the WikiLeaks Task Force, Julian. I'm on those Twitter feeds. And so when it came out with all the photographs and everything for Vault 7 leading up to the actual release, they've even got me downloading stuff, right? I'm downloading stuff. I find it later on my laptop and I say, now, how did this get here? And then I remember, oh, I downloaded that from the various keys and all of that sort of stuff. I downloaded that from, maybe I'm telling everybody what I've got on my laptop, right? Maybe I need to buy another laptop now. But I've got it all. I've got it all, because even if I don't know how to use it, I think it's valuable information and we need to have it. One day when I have nothing else to do, no more activism, then I'll teach myself how to use it.
Very cool. Okay, so we've covered off press freedom. We've covered off human rights in the historical context. I'm really interested to know what your take is. I'm not sure if you got a chance to read Being Julian Assange yet, or if you saw the original medical reports that were published by WikiLeaks. But just to take things to a bit more somber note, Julian hates to talk about how his physical condition. Because he doesn't want to make himself more vulnerable to the state than he is. And obviously for him to talk about those things is very, very difficult. But we're at the point now, after 7 years, where it can no longer be ignored that there is a mortal risk to him remaining in the embassy. We had Greg Barnes, his Australian legal advisor, Julian's legal advisor, on last night, and he said the situation is untenable. You can't physically keep someone in a room without even letting them walk around the block once for 7 years. You can't have someone unable to look at natural light for 7 years. There was a very ominous mention by another one of Julian's lawyers sometime a couple of weeks ago that Julian would not be able to see down the hallway because his eyes have been deprived of anything except artificial light for 7 years. That to me is unacceptable. It's unacceptable for any human being to be kept in those conditions, whether it's a prisoner at Guantanamo, whether it is a, you know, whatever. No person should be kept in that. The United Nations have said he is being arbitrarily detained. His conditions are now amount to torture. The doctors in the medical reports didn't even want to disclose their names for fear of retribution. This is the world that we live in. The West, the champion of human rights and democracy and freedom, the doctors can't admit that they're doctors because they may be politically persecuted for being doctors of Julian Assange. I would like your take. Do you know of any precedent for this? And I would like your take on this, the pressing and urgent situation with regards to Julian's health and his medical situation.
Well, yes, this is a somber but necessary discussion. Because the fact of the matter is that Julian is under threat and his life is in danger. That danger comes from many different sources. But those sources, the multiplicity of the sources, in the end, don't change anything about the health status of Julian Assange. And that is also something that desperately needs to be raised. And, well, you know, he is in custody, a kind of custody that when I think about the most hardened criminals who are in US prisons, they at least get exercise in sunlight, you know? So you think about it, no direct sunlight, no, gosh, the normal pleasures of just being outside, no grounding, putting your feet in the dirt, in the soil, in the grass, not able to, you know, the singing of the birds, the buzzing of the bees, you just, none of that we kind of take for granted, he is experiencing. And what makes this all the more criminal is that there is a responsibility for the current US administration to resolve this issue in a way that is favorable and consistent with the US Constitution. But it's not happening. So instead of draining the swamp, President Trump has found swamp monsters and added adornments to their their being, their personas.
He put a pool bar in the swamp and some floaties.
Yes, that's right. That's right. It made the swamp an even more desirable location if your aspiration is to be a swamp monster. So that's not draining the swamp. The system is rigged. Yeah, you told us the system is rigged. But the information that is contained in WikiLeaks helps to unrig the system. So now, why aren't you liberating us so that we can have more access to information, and that the person who provided this platform to us, whose integrity remains intact to this day, has his life at risk? What's going on there? The responsibility of the Ecuador government, it's all been spelled out. These people are politicians. They know what their responsibilities are. They know even how they got into office. But the swamp is mighty. It's like it's got a magnet, and it slips magnets into the pockets of people who might try to drain it. So they become stuck in the swamp rather than liberating us from the swamp. And so the Trump administration definitely has abdicated all responsibilities, which is shameful. And so too have the other governments. I kind of would like to see, I've been thinking about ways in which maybe we could address that situation. I don't know.
Cynthia,
yeah.
You know, the US government tells us Martin Luther King Jr. was, you know, a historic, heroic figure, and we should celebrate the limited civil rights aspects of his work, and certainly not his anti-war or any other platforms, you know, anti-capitalism thoughts, platforms, ideas. What I'm really interested in is to what extent was Dr. Martin Luther King smeared prior to his assassination? We all know about the FBI COINTELPRO letter, but what I'm wondering is there parallels between like the smears that Julian's been enduring since 2010, now 8 years of them, and other such leaders?
Oh my gosh, yes, absolutely. And you know, you were talking about the pattern of sort of the template,
the methods
that's being used, right? So yeah, there's a template of methods also being used against Julian and other political prisoners. Julian is a political prisoner. And we can look at many political prisoners, current political prisoners inside the United States that are incarcerated in the US. And I hadn't thought about that before, but yeah, Julian is a political prisoner who needs to be freed.
That's precisely why I keep likening the kind of effort that I see us needing to undertake as being like free Mandela movement level.
Yes. Yes, but it's a shame. It's a shame we should even have to do this. I mean, this is It's, well, anyway, you know, we can express our outrage because we must. We can express our disgust because we must. But in the end, I think we just have to keep kicking the ball down the field. If it's 99 yards that we have to travel, maybe we do it 1 yard at a time, but just never stop.
Well, we've got some pretty good traction in terms of our last vigil was 14 guests or 13 guests in 10 hours. This vigil is 25 guests in 25 hours. We're heading in the right direction in that sense. Also, there is a number of actions planned by completely different organizing groups and organizing committees. There is a big embassy, a UK embassy vigil on the 19th of June, and that's all locations all around the world. The first time, I think I've seen about 12 or 15 different locations, cities that there will be embassy vigils at. So I think we're starting to get there, you know. And I was saying earlier, the mass movements, where I've twice seen my country achieve critical mass. They didn't win either, but they achieved critical mass. They got to the point where every single person in the country knew about the issue, about the movement, and about what was happening. And in both of those instances, it took years. In the TPPA No Way campaign, it was probably 5 years to get to the point where literally every single person in the country understood what the TPP was, what it stood for, what was in it, why they should oppose it, why other people were opposing it, and for there to be rallies at literally every town and city in the country. With the movement against the spy agencies, it was a bigger, faster scandal, so it didn't take as long. It was 8 months of organizing to get to the point where we had town hall meetings, and then it was about another year of organizing before we got to the point of total saturation and critical mass. Wow. Now, our politicians still shafted us. And that's why I say we didn't win. We got close, but we didn't win. But we did educate the entire country. And we did, you know, have a lot of social impacts in positive ways. So I still consider it, in some ways, you can have victories without achieving the primary objective. Mm-hmm. And I'm still grateful for those, the unintended victories, maybe we call them. But I know in the Nelson Mandela movement, which obviously was a far bigger deal because it was a worldwide movement, a global movement. I know it took best part of 20 years from the very first grassroots organizing, but the serious global organizing, I think, was 8 years. They had to campaign for 8 years to put enough pressure on to be turning the leaders of countries onto their side to push for freedom for Nelson Mandela. I think when we start to see a leader of a country that is not Ecuador standing up and calling the US and UK out for everything that they have done, maybe that will be the beginning of the tide changing for Julian, when we can get pressure at that level, and we can, you know, not just at the local level, not just at the Senate, not just at wherever, but actually leaders of countries, because that's what we saw with Nelson Mandela. Mm-hmm. You know, when we start seeing leaders of countries going to hold summits in the US to negotiate over the detention of Julian Assange, perhaps, and I'm speculating at this point, but I'm just basing this off what we saw with Nelson Mandela. So I think that sustained pressure is the key to actually achieving our objective.
I have a question that maybe you can consider and we can discuss it later on, but I'm wondering, what's the price of, I almost don't know how to put it. What's the price of keeping Julian not free? How can I say, how can we raise the price to those who are How can we raise the price of the continued incarceration of Julian? I don't know if I'm saying that the way.
I understand what you're saying, and it's a really interesting question. I mean, the ultimate price for the US would be if they were stupid enough to breach the embassy and violate the Vienna Convention, and they thereby created a precedent where nobody that they ever housed in an American embassy anywhere in the world would ever be safe again. That's the ultimate price that I can think of. The next ultimate price would be if they kill Julian one way or another, if they cause his death one way or another, and the insurance file encryption keys are released, and the most highly sensitive documents start raining from the sky all around the world in the wake of Julian's passing. That I would think would be the second highest price for the US, because you can guarantee that whatever WikiLeaks has been stashing away in those files all these years is going to be some pretty damning, earth-shattering stuff. In terms of raising the political price on them, unifying may actually be enough, because so much time and effort, really the continuance of the Democratic and Republican parties, the Democrat and Republican parties, hinges upon division.
Right.
So if we can achieve, if we can teach people that, I mean, it's really like teaching them to learn a bicycle. It's like, oh, I can't do it. I'm wobbling and falling off. No, you can do it. Oh, look, now you're away laughing and you're doing it all by yourself. I see it as a similar kind of thing, because there's absolutely nothing that I've done this weekend or in organizing this that other people couldn't do. It's not even that I had a little black book with everyone's numbers in it because I'm some special person like that at all. I was just persistent about reaching out through people, through people to other people and so on and so forth. Anybody can network like that. And anybody can hold a web conference, and anyone can decide to spend a weekend doing this stuff. And I mean, to also, I'd like to point out too, because there's actually, there's been several references today to like me being the organizer. I actually see that as really unfair, because there's, I appreciate that people are wanting to express gratitude for the event's existence. But I do want to point out that there is like dozens and dozens and dozens of people behind the scenes who have made all of this happen. And I literally couldn't have done it without them. So, but anybody can get together a team one by one, find out people. I mean, I'm saying all the time on Twitter, like today, I'm like, oh, who's got video editing skills? We need some videos edited, you know, come work with me. Let's do it. And I mean, this is the spirit that Internet Party is built on. All of the resources that we have, they're not financial resources. We have no money, but we have people willing to utilize their skills into volunteer services, and anybody can do that. Other than uniting, having a single purpose. And when I say uniting too, I don't mean uniting as a central organization. I don't mean that at all. I mean just crossing ideological divides and barriers to inclusion and include making a space available to everyone, be that digitally, online, or physically on the ground. Just being hospitable to 99% of the population. That's really all I can say that truly threatens the power structure, that spends so many billions of dollars trying to divide us and trying to stop us from working together. I think, this is the tagline for this event, right? Is unity in a world of divide and conquer, unity is the ultimate act of resistance.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Going and marching against each other is not an act of resistance.
Yes. So that's what I'm looking at now. I just was jotting some notes down. Those, if we go by the Paulo Freire, unity, cooperation, organization, and cultural synthesis. And what I wanted to explore was how do we increase the price paid by, I guess, the controllers of the system? How do we make it more costly for them to maintain their control over us? I think that's the question I'm trying to ask. And then, of course, I think you're also right when you say that it is the very act of us being united, us cooperating, us organizing, us creating this something new, this kind of new culture that is a blend of all of who we are that are engaged in this process and its project, that in and of itself increases the price that the overlords have to pay, because then we force them to pay more attention in order for them to carry on their business as usual. The prices increase, and that means they have to spend more effort in order to conduct business as usual. They have to expend more effort to conduct business as usual, and we are organized in an extremely decentralized, like I was talking about, that complex adaptive system, an extremely decentralized way, then we eliminate the power that they have of the divide and rule, because once they can lop off one set of organizations over here, or the leaders of one set of organizations over here, but because of the way we're structured, new leaders will pop up over there. So I think that we have to become more of a threat to the status quo operatives. And like you say, these are the ones, and from COINTELPRO, we know that the number one methodology used by the FBI was infiltration. So decentralization is also a way to eliminate the gross negative consequences of infiltration.
That's just reminded me of something that they say in the tech community. They talk about reducing your threat surface.
Yes.
So you, right. in the short term, you elevate your threat surface. For example, like doing the stream might elevate my threat surface because they'd be pretty unhappy about it. There's been a vast lengths gone to today to try to suppress the hashtag, shadow ban our accounts, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But then I might decide to spend the next 3 months, I don't know, playing softball.
Yes. But the work goes on, and that's what's important for us to establish, that the work goes on, but it's at a different center of leadership. It's coming from a different center or centers of leadership. That's the model I think that we have to implement. And I know that there are some people who are devoting full time to what that resistance, that more perfect resistance model is. But we owe it to ourselves to have some of our leaders, of our resistance leaders, thinking along this lines as to what is the correct model for us as we, I guess you could say, even professionalize our dissent. So like, for example, I've been dissenting for gosh, all my life in one way or another, I've been dissenting. And so now dissent has just become a way that I operate. It's become like the normal thing for me. Okay, get to the airport 15, 20 minutes earlier, because you know you're not going through that Michael Chertoff machine, right? You know, you're going to get a full body pat down. You're going to get the four S's on your boarding card. But the idea of conforming, no, we need to have more people like that. I remember visiting a We Are Change group in London. And they said, okay, we will use the system to clog the system. So what they did was they used public transportation in London, in the London area. But whenever those cameras capture your face or image, then you have a right to receive that image of you captured by the state, whether it's the tube system or whatever. And so that's what they do. They go about their lives, but they know that they're going to apply to get their, you know, sort of like their freedom of information. I want to see what did you get on my face today? And so the system is clogged with these requests for what the system promised that it would provide, but that it never expected to give. And so what I do is I just don't go through that Michael Chertoff machine at the airport and make the TSA people do what they are there to do, which also provides an opportunity for me to teach them why the government cares nothing about them and the radiation that they're exposed to. And, you know, I'm just a peace person anyway. So now why am I getting the extra screening when all I advocate is peace and I never am advocating the wars? So I always use these as opportunities, these engagements as opportunities. Now I'm trying to do my communications in encryption. Why? Because that kind of clogs up the system again. And you know, we know that they are snatching up everything, but they have to go maybe a little bit extra when they slow it down a little bit, when the communications are in encryption. So there are little things that we can do in order to increase the price that the system, quote unquote system, but we know that the system is nothing more than the individuals that populate it, that increase the price for these negative behaviors that are associated with the system. And we just need to figure out, Julian has inspired us and we need to protect Julian. And then at the same time, we need to figure out ways in which we can make the system pay every day, every hour of the day for what it does to Julian and what it is doing to us.
That is very reminiscent of what Snowden said about why end-to-end encryption is so laborious for the system to deal with, because it forces them to target people individually and they are no longer able to target people in bulk. So it was exactly that same argument, that it's increasing the resource demand on the spy agencies when we start to take some responsibility for protecting ourselves through end-to-end encryption. Cynthia, I'm going to jump up really quickly and run to the bathroom and grab a cup of water, and then I need to bring Mark Crispin Miller on, who's the media studies professor.
Oh, tell him hi.
Yeah, at New York University. So I'll be scintillated to hear what he has to say, because I'm very interested, specifically from a media perspective, about Julian's situation and about WikiLeaks as a whole. I would like, please, for you to take 3 minutes to just send your messages out, your final messages to Julian and WikiLeaks, final for this stream, certainly not final messages, but please, if you could share your last thoughts, and if the day comes where Julian is able to see this stream, please give your, let him know what you'd like to tell him, and I will be right back.
Okay. Well, I think what I would like to leave this stream with is, first of all, the message to Julian is that we already know you are strong. And thanks to organizers like Susie, we are trying to lift you and your strength for just a little longer. And in the civil rights movement, they used to say, keep your eyes on the prize. So this is one of the ways in which we can all keep our eyes on the prize, and you are the prize, Julian. You're the prize. And you gave us this wonderful platform, WikiLeaks. And we know far more now about what our government has done with our tax dollars in our name than we knew before there was a WikiLeaks. We know who the real criminals are, and it's not you, Julian. We've got to figure out a way to hold them accountable for the crimes that are being committed daily as a result of what's being done to you. Yes, it is torture. And also for the crimes that are being committed around the world, because governments are being given, individuals who populate these governments are being given the right to commit crimes with impunity. They're seizing that right. They're stealing that right from we the, well, it's not even a right. They're stealing the ability. And so because of your pain and the pain of your family, I've seen the interviews of your mother, who is also a very strong woman. Just hang in there a little bit longer, because the whole world is coming to your rescue. You at least can know, you and your mom can know that the whole world is coming to your rescue. I think that's probably the most important message for you. And the important message for the rest of us is that we can't stop. Just as the forces of oppression are unrelenting against us, we must be unrelenting in our dissent against them. And as Susie discussed, it is, we balance our visibility. We manage our visibility. But every day, 24/7, 365, is about perfecting our resistance. That's my commitment.
So. That is absolutely gorgeous.
Thank you so much, Susie, for including. Oh,
I am so grateful to have had you here with me. And I know so many other people who have been watching are grateful as well. So thank you so much.
You're okay. Just being absolutely incredible. This time I can actually say bye appropriately without the darn everything shutting off.
Big love to you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
See you, Cynthia. Thank you so much.